Let's bow our heads and hearts in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we come before you and acknowledge that we need the tutoring of your Holy Spirit to understand that which you have been pleased to inspire in your word, to even understand it at any level, much less to have it do the work you intend in our lives to change us, and to bring us into greater conformity to you. So, Holy Spirit, be our tutor. We pray you would bless us, Lord, with the love that overcomes so many of the divisions that separate us from one another. Divisions of race and gender and class and background and language and every other man-made device as well, Lord, that by which we gauge others and elevate ourselves at their expense. Help us to listen to views that we don't agree with consideration and respect, and to be the salt and light you intend us to be as your people, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. I was not really planning to return to this topic again this morning, and I'm sure that if you happen to see it advertised, that may be one reason why you decide to stay home. But there were a number of people who asked questions, not surprisingly, after the service on Sunday and then through the week, pointing out that I didn't explain this after getting us all encouraged about the equality and value, the profound value of women. I didn't mention any kind of explanation for why so much attention is given to Eve's deception. That just seems a little bit of like a put-down. And there were other questions that came out as well, and so I felt like there was a need for dealing with some odds and ends here. And then the Supreme Court's decision on Friday likewise raised additional questions. Some of you are aware that there is a very strong link between the way evangelical believers have interpreted the Bible's teachings about the role of women and the Bible's teaching about sexual morality, and particularly same-sex relationships. There's a what would be called a hermeneutical parallel in the sense that there are many, as we will see this morning, who view the Bible's teaching about women to be culture-bound. Not just simply framed in a way that has a cultural context, so that we hear about braids being a sign of ostentatious adornment. Those of you who are women with braids may have been feeling a little intimidated by that. Well, in the biblical world, there were braids of a kind that we do not see. Very elaborate use of the intertwining of strands of hair, often along with strands of gold and jewelry, that was, to the viewpoint of the Christian community in that culture, really over the top in terms of its display of materialism that put others ill at ease. Anyway, so yeah, there's a cultural translation that always has to be made in the Bible, but that doesn't mean that its truths are culturally relative, that they are somehow or other to be dismissed. That's just for then, not for now. And yet, that has been one approach to this topic, and we'll talk about that. As far as the Supreme Court's decision, of course, this is nothing new for us living in Massachusetts. We've been living with same-sex marriage since 2004. But it does remind us once again of what is a very important principle in Scripture, where we distinguish between what's legal and what is moral. I mean, that sometimes gets blurred in the public mind, but for us, it's never the case that all of our moral precepts are codified in law. That wasn't even true in the Old Testament. Even in the theocracy, God had a very libertarian approach to law on matters, well, like even in terms of sexual morality. The Old Testament is absolutely, unequivocally opposed to prostitution, both for the women and for the men. We looked at texts in Hosea and elsewhere where the men are condemned for going to prostitutes just as much as the women. But it was for that reason that God would not have a criminalizing policy with respect to prostitution, because perhaps the problem of prosecution, the tendency would be to capture and prosecute just women instead of women and men, and perhaps there are other reasons as well. But in any case, in the Bible, it's not criminally punished, but it is condemned. And so we are used to living with this difference between what we believe has got to guide our lives in terms of the Lord's law for us, His moral precepts for us, compared to our culture. It's perfectly legal to hate your enemies. In fact, it actually makes a lot of sense. They hate you, after all. But it isn't moral. If you want to live for the master of the universe, if you take to heart Jesus' invitation to come and follow Him, then now, all of a sudden, if you love Him, you'll keep His commands, He says. And one of His commands is, oddly enough, to love your enemies, even pray for them. That's not something that you can do just through willpower. It's got to be a work of God in you to make it real. Likewise, it's perfectly legal to harbor bitterness against someone who has murdered a loved one, to be so distressed at the wrongness, the evil of that act, that you would be forever caught up in a cycle of hate and bitterness in response. But that's not what Jesus wants for us. It's legal, but it isn't moral. Jesus said in His Sermon on the Mount, "If you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive you your sins." So, yes, there's a great disparity between what is moral and what is legal. Are the Bible's morals about women out of date? Well, I've tried to already in four previous sermons argue, no, we couldn't imagine better morals. And so today we're going to look at more of that teaching of Scripture regarding the role of women, and looking at that passage in 1 Timothy that I read for you in chapter 2, that wonderful Christians, well-informed, earnest followers of Christ have differed over its interpretation in terms of particularly two major camps, the egalitarian view and the complementarian view. We'll explain that. And I want to bring to your attention a third view, the marital view, or cruciform view, that I think has much to commend it. I can speak about all these because at one point in my life I held every one of these views and some others beside. I'm not going to throw stones at anybody. If this is your view, we want you to feel at home here, but I think it's helpful for all of us to see the grounding in Scripture that they each try to reflect. And then I want to talk about practical applications. But that Supreme Court decision does raise questions for us, and our we having some new response? Well, no, we've always been called to be salt and light, to live countercultural lives. Nothing's changed, to overcome evil with good if we feel distressed over some of the possible implications for the abridgment of religious freedom. That's fine. The Christian church has grown perfectly well in the midst of persecution, as well as in situations that are much more affable. In any case, it's legal to be bitter, but the families of those nine victims of Emmanuel AME Church, because they're following Christ, did something that is absolutely astounding. They followed Jesus' precept that if you forgive men when they sin against you, then your heavenly Father will also forgive you. Nadine Collier, the daughter of one of the victims, told Dylan Roof, the murderer, "You took something very precious from me, and I will never talk to her again." Speaking of her mother, "I will never, ever hold her again. But I forgive you, and may God have mercy on your soul." That's astonishing to be able to say that without reading a script. To have it be said from your heart under such a circumstance is inconceivable, in fact. Such love, and yet there is no contradiction between that astounding love, that gracious mercy, the welcome that was extended even to the murderer, as was mentioned by Felicia Sanders, one of the three survivors of the shooting. She said, we welcomed you Wednesday night at our Bible study and with welcome arms. Every fiber in my body hurts. But as we said at the Bible study, may God have mercy on you. There's no contradiction between that level of love and the conviction of what our 12,000 congregations and 7.5 million members of the African Methodist Episcopal Church that has refused to condone same-sex marriages. You say, well, wait a minute, are they against, it's an African-American denomination, the largest in the country, are they against civil rights? Of course not. Are they in favor of bigotry? No, they even welcomed a white guy into their Bible study, no questions asked. They're not prejudging anyone. Welcome, open arms, extraordinary love. And yet, because they follow Christ's teachings, yes, their ministers cannot perform a same-sex marriage all across the country. Why is that? Is that just a tradition? No, it's because they're following Jesus. Jesus, when asked about the question of sexual relationships, does not hesitate to base his teaching on the scriptures, the Old Testament scriptures. He wasn't just making this up. It's Genesis to Revelation, the beginning of the end of the Bible, is one in terms of its moral demands. So Christ, who didn't come to set aside the Old Testament's morals, though to fulfill all of its promises, quotes Genesis 1. Haven't you read, he replied, that at the beginning the Creator made them male and female? And said, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. That's what Jesus said. You know, we may at times wonder why we have so much freedom in this country, freedom in terms of gun control issues, freedom in terms of pornography on the internet. We have more freedom than some of us might wish, and more than we, for ourselves, not for others, but for ourselves, find actually not all that helpful. But while we rejoice in a country that has such freedoms, even freedom to sin, we answer to a higher authority, or we're trying to. We're trying to walk after him, imitating him. And so then when he goes on and surprised his disciples by responding to their questions about marriage, he actually gives only two options. When it comes to your sexual life, there's option one, and then there's option two. There's option one, which is the option of marriage as he describes it, and it's marriage with absolute unquestioned fidelity in the context of a heterosexual relationship. And then there's celibacy. And the disciples, of course, when they heard the first, said, it's better, my goodness, if that's true, it's better not to get married. It sounds like a prison sentence. You have to confine all your love to this one woman. How can we do that? Well, you got another option, Jesus said. And the other option, it's unclear which is worse, from their point of view. Jesus astonished them. Two options. But there's no third option. It's the law of the excluded middle. So yes, he did address same-sex issues, but he didn't just say a big no. He actually said a much bigger yes, and we need to as well. Because you see, Jesus has a reason for no third option. He's the model for all of our love relationships. He's the model for our same-sex love relationships, and he's the model for our heterosexual love relationships. The Bible has him, well, John the Baptist, the prophet who was to point everyone to Jesus. When everyone started going to Jesus, and some of John's disciples, were afraid that Jesus' church was growing faster than John's, they went to John the Baptist and said, what do you think about the fact so many are going to Jesus to be baptized? And John said, look, I'm not the Christ, but I was sent ahead of him. The bride, meaning the people of God, belong to the bridegroom. He's the one who points out this marriage metaphor as applied to Jesus. Jesus is the groom. We're the bride. And so in his relationship to his church, he is the model for marriage. That's what the prophet John the Baptist was pointing to, and Jesus endorses that later on, and then Paul, as you know, picks up on it when he says, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for it. You and I have hardly ever seen such a marriage, But we have the model in Christ who loves us and loves us into this model, into making our marriages look more like it. You say, well, I don't have a marriage like that right now. In fact, maybe you're not even married. That's fine. We'll get to you in a sec. If you have a marriage and it doesn't look like this, good news. This is a welcoming congregation. You're welcome here. You came to the right place. Jesus loves you. He loves you so much, every one of you, just as you are. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He loves you and welcomes you to come to Him just as you are. You don't have to clean up your act or anything. Just come to Him. Give your life to Him. He died for you. Respond by giving your life to Him. No questions asked. But He does also love you too much to leave you the way you are. He loves you so much He'll accept you and welcomes you the way you are, but He loves you too much to leave you the way you are. And He starts right away changing you from the inside, changing your desires. It isn't turning you into some kind of a mindless robot where you now automatically obey Him. It's going to be a hard won work of sanctification that He's about, but He's doing it. And little by little, as you, well, my experiences, I look at some of your marriages and they put me in my marriage to shame. You're like walking marriage counselors when you come to our house and visit, and I see a husband caring for his wife and saying kind things. And, you know, anyway, that's the plan. But it's also the plan with respect to our same-sex relationships. You may not be married. You may not have same-sex attraction, or maybe you do, but God has given to us the model of not solitary confinement, but of a love-filled life, of meaningful relationships, of committed relationships, of affectionate relationships, just not sexualized relationships. Not same-sex sex, but same-sex love. We're in favor of it. We're all in support of it. We say yes to same-sex love. If it's all about love, we're in favor of it. But not if it's about sex, because Jesus is not about in favor of it. He does not sexualize any of these relationships, though they are very tender and affectionate. He's the one who instituted the practice of allowing His disciples to greet Him and He them with a kiss. In fact, as you know, Judas used that sign of affection to betray the Savior, if you can believe it. It is very possible to kiss someone and actually not love them, apparently. Real friendship is self-sacrificial. It puts the other first. Greater love has no one than this, that he lay down his life for his friends. That's the kind of same-sex love we want. And we want to be light and salt in this society so that they see what they've always wanted. Other who don't have the kind of privilege you and I have to have people who really care about you, who will not only provide and help in practical ways, but are not afraid to give you their time and attention, who actually will read your Christmas letter because they're interested in you, and you will read theirs. Our concern about the response to the church in the wake of this Supreme Court judicial decision is that we do not, if we are representing Jesus, the friend of tax collectors and sinners, do we look like we're representing Him? If we're going around with placards of hatred or a scowl on our face and look all grumpy like the world is falling apart, we're not looking like Jesus. We can't give in to these attitudes. We've got to adopt the approach He took, the friend of tax collectors and sinners, who actually even ate with them, to the chagrin of the religious authorities of the day, who made friends with them and won them to Himself. Did He ever lower the moral standard? No, you can actually do this. You can be loving and welcoming, inviting, and yet still hold unflinchingly this standard to which God is calling us, a life full of same-sex love that is self-sacrificial, just like the cross. And then He says, I have not come to call the righteous but sinners to repentance. You see, there is a standard, there's a plan. He loves you too much to leave you the way you are. He has a plan. And if you've come to this place wanting that plan, you came to the right place if you want to repent of your failures, whatever they are. Likewise, with the woman taken in adultery, then neither do I condemn you. Go, just do whatever you want. No, that's not what he's... Neither do I condemn you. Go now and leave your life of sin. That's what he said to me. That's what he said to Dave Bliss or to Debbie Bliss, our missionaries. That's what he says to you. That's what he says to everyone. He loves us that much, that friend. So the church, we're Sinners Anonymous. We boast of the largest AA group in all of Boston. Well, we got an even larger SA. The SA group is amazing. Look at yourselves. We're massive, and we're helping each other start on a new path in life, following him. Not doing a great job of it, but bound and determined. Though the righteous, though the sinful man falls seven times, we, the righteous, rise again. We stand up again and try again. So we're on to this debate about how to interpret the passage. It's been distressingly divisive in the Christian church, and some of you know this. On the one side, the egalitarians who hold that there are no roles within the church that would exclude a woman, and that there's then absolutely in a kind of equality, even obviously based on gifts, but nevertheless not in any way reflecting a gender issue. And there's an organization even to encourage those who have this view, Christians for Biblical Equality. They do a lot of publication. On the other side, another group called Complementarian, who take the view that there are roles in the Christian church that are not open to women. And they too have their organization, the Council for Biblical Manhood and Womanhood. I want to look at their views and see where they're helpful and where there may be some issues. But the result is the one thing we don't want. The one thing that we do not want is everybody fighting, getting into trouble because, you know, well, we think so much is at stake, and why can't you see things my way? We need to be respectful and listening. And that's why in this church, even though I have a favorite view, you're hearing about two views that aren't my favorite view, in addition to my favorite view. I want men everywhere to lift up holy hands in prayer without anger or disputing. The verse begins with this. And isn't it funny that something that begins with that ends with all this fighting, with churches dividing, whole denominations dividing over this issue? There's a kind of a divine irony here. It's like the Lord planted this in there right at the very point where everyone's going to be fighting, reminding them that, no, he doesn't want anger, disputing. So we better learn how to, if we're going to fight over these verses, let's at least listen to the first of them. So here's the debate. The key text is verse 12 and 13. I read it, and maybe you were cringing as I read it. I do not permit a woman to teach or to have authority over a man. She must be silent, for Adam was formed first, then Eve. The egalitarian view looks at that. They read the same Bible. They love the Lord. They want their view to be honoring to him and obedient to the word. And they yet have this view that there's no distinct roles for men or women in the church or in marriage for that matter. And you say, well, where do they get that? Well, they get it from the large number of general texts that seem to be worthy of controlling our exegesis, of helping to define our interpretation, especially of difficult passages. When we have Peter at Pentecost saying, no, this was what was spoken by the prophet Joel in the last days. God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. And as we know in the Bible, when you have these lists of gifts, prophecy is usually listed before pastoring and teaching. And like it's right under apostle. So it's enormously impressive that daughters will be prophesying. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. We're not going to have ageism here. Even on your servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. So even, you know, in fact, in the early church, not too long after the first century, there was a pope who was a slave. Is there a reason why a slave can't be a pope? No. Because within the body of Christ, we're not showing preference based on your socioeconomic status. If you have the gifts, you could be called to be moderator of Park Street Church or whatever. even if your job or your education looks, you know, not as impressive as someone else's based on worldly standards. Not surprisingly, Paul then summarizes it this way: there's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. You know, it's this massive eradication of the barriers by which we evaluate one another and size one another up and create a kind of hierarchy. That doesn't mean that there is no distinction. We are a body of Christ, and one part can be the arm or another the leg. It's not identity. It's not that male and female are now identical. It's just that one is no longer in any sense disadvantaged over the other, separated, inferior. The setting of the text, and we're going to look at this for each of these views. We're going to look first at setting. The setting that's assumed by the interpreters is corporate worship. After all, it begins, "I want men everywhere to lift up holy hands in prayer without anger or disputing." And it's argued that even though it doesn't say this is in church, that, well, where do people lift up their hands? You know, isn't it like in church? That's, you know, you don't do that like unless you're hailing a cab, you know, out there. You know, so it's thought that maybe this is confined to church, an evidence that all these rules have to do with church, the assembly of believers. And then the anger and disputing. You can't be in your prayer closet having anger or disputing. So even if you pray like this at home, you know, who are you going to be arguing with, right? So the argument is that, well, that also implies a church setting. And everywhere, it says everywhere, I want men everywhere. Well, now this gets a little bit iffy. But the standard view is everywhere doesn't mean quite everywhere. It means in each of the house churches around Ephesus. I saw a couple of noses squidging a little there. Well, that's the view. And then maybe the teaching. So what's the problem? We know the setting. Now what's the problem according to the egalitarian view? The problem that Paul is addressing is that the women at Ephesus had been deceived. And if they've been deceived, maybe it's because they were not well educated in the scriptures, but anyway, or maybe they're just prone to deception. You know how women are, that people say that. They've been deceived, and if you let them be teachers, they'll deceive others. And so that's why in verse 14, which I never got to before, it says, "And Adam was not the one deceived, it was the woman who was deceived and became a sinner." It's understood that this is an explanation for why they would not be allowed, women won't be allowed to teach, because the women were deceived. The Spirit clearly says in latter times people are going to get even deceiving spirits, etc. And so there are other references to deception in the book too. We'll jump ahead. And so the woman, being deceived, is better off just sitting quietly. Don't get in a ruckus or whatever. Listen quietly. Be teachable, because you do need to do some learning. This is the egalitarian view. However, the good news is, it's only as long as you've been deceived and are still under your deception. In other words, the application is a temporary instruction from Paul. It only applies to women who have been deceived that need to get their act together. Then it will no longer apply to them. So there's a kind of, "I do not permit," he says, "a woman to teach or to have authority." I'm supposed to be landing pretty soon. Sorry. And that can be paraphrased, "I am now not permitting." In Greek, it's the present tense. "I am now not permitting a woman to teach." But, you know, eventually, or Phillips translation, "personally, I don't allow women to teach." That's how Phillips translates it. And so this is not something that would apply to us. Paul is just dealing with that situation there at Ephesus with women who had been misled. And so we could say that once the women go to seminary or get away from some of these bad influences, sure enough, the time clock will stop and they can now teach. Gordon Fee, who was one of the professors at Gordon-Conwell, and when I was a student at seminary there, most of the professors actually held this view that I've just shared with you. People that are, I adore them. They're amazingly gifted people. I praise God for Gordon Fee, who is now with the Lord, but wrote some wonderful commentaries and did excellent scholarship. But this is what he says. By saying, I am now or I am not permitting, Paul focuses particularly on the situation in Ephesus. Such language as this, as well as I want, he mentions in verse 8 about the men not raising hands and arguing and all that. Language like that lacks any sense of universal imperative for all situations. This is just for them. All right? That's the egalitarian view. We've now dealt with it. The other view is the complementarian view. The Danvers statement defines this view as those who hold some governing and teaching roles within the church are restricted to men. Doesn't say which ones, but there are some that are just for the men. And typically, of course, these are the leading roles, of some kind, the teaching roles, according to the complementarian view, not just the janitorial roles, let's say. So we'll symbolize it with just the one guy. The setting, in the view of the complementarians, is the same as the egalitarians. They all agree on this. We're talking about in church. Therefore, complementarians have no trouble with a German chancellor who's a woman. In society as a whole, women can be in authority and they can do lots of teaching. They can teach at universities and so on. Complementarians don't have a difficulty with that. It's only in the church, as when gathered, not even in the church in detail, but in when we're gathered in particular. Because, well, again, they're using all the same arguments. Everywhere is the house churches and so on. So, and the problem, they also agree that the women of Ephesus may have been deceived, but here's the difference. This is not why they are not allowed to teach or lead or teach a man. It is not because they were deceived, and so if we get rid of their deception by making sure they get better Bible studies, that will not change the situation. They're still not allowed. Only the reason for arguing this is actually a good one. The complementarians point out that only false teachers are mentioned in either 1 Timothy or 2. So if Paul is concerned about deceivers teaching, he should be saying, I don't permit a man to teach. Because it's only the men who are deceiving others with their deceptive teaching. If you read through the books, both books, it's only men who are named and described. For example, in 1 Timothy chapter 1, it should say. The reason why women are not to teach or have authority is instead not because they're deceived, but because Adam was formed first, then Eve. That's why. Verse 13, according to the complementarian, is the reason. And that is not going to change. That's going to be true in 2015, just as it was back then. It's an argument from creation order. And so the complementarian view is it's permanent, it's normative for all time. The application, the third thing we're looking at, the application, these exhortations are not temporary and not culturally relative. I do not permit does not mean I'm not now permitting as if someday I could. Yes, there are needs to pay attention to context like braided hair, but that's not relativizing what Paul said. Wayne Grudem, who is a friend of mine and a former member of Park Street Church years ago, has pointed out that Paul says I some 760 times in his letters. And if we start saying, well, whenever he says I don't permit, I do this, I that, we're not going to have a New Testament. If all of it's just back then and not doesn't apply now. He said, for example, I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present or future, nor any other power can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. Now, he says, I'm convinced. Do we read that and say, well, that's you, Paul. I don't need to be convinced of that. No, what Paul says, he says authoritatively. What he is saying, he implies we ought to take to heart. And that his writings about this, even though they're in occasional letters, these writings are the Word of God. That's why he says he wants them read in the assembly. Paul is asking the churches to read his letters when the only thing they read together was Scripture, because he knew he had been filled with the Spirit and had the authority of, as an apostle of Christ, commissioned by Christ personally to teach these things in an authoritative way. I think Wayne Grudem is right. And if you actually look at some of the things that where Jesus, Paul, or others say things, even in 1 Timothy, he uses the present tense. I urge. It's not I am now urging and later on I'm not going to feel this way. I urge, present tense, then first of all that requests, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for everyone, for kings and all those in authority, even for supreme courts and presidents. We should be praying regularly. We don't probably pray nearly enough of them as we ought. But that when Paul says I urge or I recommend or whatever it is, it is coming across as an authoritative statement. I want men everywhere to lift up holy hands. Well, that's fine, Paul. I'm glad you want it, but doesn't apply to me. That's not the right response. If he wants it, he's writing as an apostle of Christ. It's Jesus who's saying, I want it through Paul. So in this way, I am definitely in agreement with the complementarians and actually have belonged to their organization because I like their exegesis better on that point. Wayne Grudem helps us out to see what this means. Now let's talk about application. If they are interpreting the Bible correctly, then Wayne suggests that out of 35 possible areas of teaching, the general view of the biblical counsel of manhood, womanhood, or for Danvers statement would be that everything above the line might be permitted or is permitted, including teaching a Bible course in seminary. Is prohibited. You can't, if you're a woman, you should not be allowed. You can teach Hebrew, but you can't teach the Bible. You can preach, well, you can't preach regularly, but hey, number six, you can occasionally preach to the whole church on Sunday mornings. So even if I haven't convinced you of my view and you are a complementarian, you should be very happy at Park Street Church. Because when you hear one of our wonderful women preachers who don't preach as long as I do, so the revival breaks out every time they preach. If you hear one of them, God can speak through them to you, and that's okay, even according to those who hold the complementarian view, or at least according to most of them. Furthermore, the Bible never condemns anyone, man or woman, from learning the truth out of someone's mouth. If a woman is preaching and you hear God's truth and you learn it and take to heart, you have not sinned in any way, shape, or form. So there's no reason. The nice thing is any egalitarian should be happy in any complementarian church, and any complementarian should be able to thrive in any egalitarian church. I can't see why they wouldn't be able to function perfectly well for these various reasons we'll go on. And there's a long list of all the other teaching things you can do if you're a woman, including missionary service, counseling, etc. There's a third interpretation that ought to be the winner, and everyone ought to be agreeing with it, but unfortunately, I haven't really succeeded in convincing even my, best friends. But anyway, here it is. It's what I call the marital view. But I have a lot of things going for it. One is that actually Martin Luther held this view of the interpretation of this text, although not believing in the ordination of women. But it's a view that has a long history, and that is to recognize that there's a translation problem here. That all of this is not about women and men in church. It's about husbands and wives in a marriage that goes everywhere you go. When you go to the store, when you're in church, when you're at home, it applies in every situation. And therefore, the translation of these words should be their usual translation. In fact, their universal translation. These are the only ways to talk about a husband and a wife. Happily, a lot of Bibles will tell you in the footnotes, or wife. And if you read the preface to the Bible, it will tell you what's in the footnote. The editors couldn't decide between the two. It's random. That it's just as good a translation. So the NIV in its new edition admits it could be a wife or husband. The New Revised Standard Version likewise admits it. Other translations adopt it. All the way back to 1937 in Luther as well. But in 1937, in the Common English Bible that's recently come out, that Fuller Seminary students are all supposed to use, It has it. Well, here's their translation. A wife should learn quietly with complete submission. I don't allow a wife to teach or to control her husband. Instead, she should be a quiet listener. So it's about marriage, according to this Common English Bible that is the latest study Bible out there. And I'm not going to jump. I want to jump ahead to. I'm not going to give you the eight arguments. I already gave them to you before. I want to just remind you of the parallel. Peter says he reads Paul's writings. So here Peter is clarifying. He says there are things in Paul's writings that are hard to understand. And there's a whole section in 1 Peter 3 that is exactly parallel to 1 Timothy 2. And every translation agrees this is about husbands, wives, and marriage. And I want them all to agree with it over here too. Because the vocabulary is the same. The actual Greek words are all the same. Every yellow word is the same on either side. And the first bit is about prayers. I want husbands everywhere to lift up holy hands in prayer without anger disputing. We'll look at it. And all this other stuff the same way. It's all parallel. There's the vocabulary over here that is found in no other passage in the whole Bible but just these two verses about the gold, the hair, the adornment, and all the rest of it. Very parallel and found with no other parallels more closely. Adam and Eve are used as an example here. Peter happens to use Sarah and Abraham as his example because of the different, well, when Paul's writing to Timothy, he's writing to a man whose one parent was a Gentile and the other parent of Jewish background, so you go right back to Adam. Okay. I didn't want to get this. Okay, I want to move on. Okay, so here we go. In summary. I don't permit a wife to order her husband around or be controlling, is the way I would translate it. She must be quiet, for Adam was formed first, then Eve. The word for controlling here, later Christian author Chrysostom says he doesn't want husbands to be that either. Whatever the word means, and there's a lot of debate about it, neither a wife nor a husband can be that. So I think controlling is the right word. The setting is not corporate worship on the marital view. Why? Well, because he says everywhere. And everywhere appears everywhere in the Bible, and everywhere else it appears in the New Testament and the Old Testament, it always means everywhere. It doesn't just mean in just some of the other little house fellowships. So everywhere means everywhere on this view. And so I'd say, you know, hey, don't you sometimes pray with raised hands all by yourself? Of course you do. You want to surrender your life to Christ again on a beautiful sunset or whatever. And you look in the Bible and you find out sometimes the lifting of hands is in groups. Other times, the text, how about Psalm 88? The psalmist says, "Oh Lord, the God who saves me day and night, I cry out to you. But may my prayer come before you. Turn your ear to my cry." He's crying out of desperate need. And then he goes on and he says, "Oh Lord, I call to you, oh Lord. Every day I spread out my hands to you." Unless the church is open day and night and everyone's assembling with him day and night, then he must be doing this by himself. And I'd say it's just one example. And why does it matter to God? In Isaiah chapter 15, he says, chapter 1, verse 15, God says through the prophet Isaiah, "When you Israelites spread out your hands in prayer, I'm going to hide my eyes from them because your hands are covered with violence." You have these gesture of surrender, but your life doesn't look like a surrender to me. And so I hate it when you use this gesture in a hypocritical way. That's why God singles it out with husbands, because they're lifting their hands, whether they're in a group or by themselves, in the midst of a life where they're being hateful toward their wives. Hateful toward their wives. The anger and disputing is with the wives. Look over in the Peter parallel. Husbands, in the same way, be considerate as you live with your wives. Treat them with respect as the weaker partner and as heirs with you of the gracious gift of life, so that nothing will hinder your prayers. The Bible talks about men's prayers being hindered in exactly these situations in marriage. In Malachi chapter 2, God says, "I'm not going to listen to you anymore because you've been unfaithful to the wife of your youth." And Peter, "I'm not going to listen to your prayers." They bounce off the ceiling. Doesn't it feel that way? It's because of the way you're treating your wife. because God is involved in the marriage covenant and he will hold you accountable to love her like Christ loves the church. And if you're not, you're not going to have your prayers answered, period. So the parallel here interprets it here. The clearer Peter tells us what anger and disputing is going on, that's wrecking prayer life. And of course, it's everywhere, as I said. And well, anyway, what's the problem in both cases? The women of Ephesus have been deceived, for sure, especially by the repudiation of marriage as an impediment to salvation. There's false teaching, and we'll look at it. Why mention Eve being deceived, the woman being deceived? It isn't because, you, as we might think, that Paul somehow or other thinks that Eve's deception is worth her sin is worse than Adam's. If she sinned because she was deceived, why did Adam sin? Whatever the reason, it must be worse, because being deceived is a mitigating circumstance, isn't it? So if Adam sinned with eyes wide open, I wouldn't want Adam teaching my church, would you? His sin would have to be worse. And by the way, Paul recognizes Adam's sin as the cause of the fall and death having come through his failure. So it's not, don't think that that's what that means. It has nothing to do with thinking Eve's sin is worse. Doesn't mean that women, they're a pushover. They're so easily deceived. No, that isn't the case either. The Apostle Paul uses the very same story of Eve's deception and says it's true of all you guys, men and women, at the church in Corinth. I'm afraid that just as Eve was deceived, your minds have been some led astray from your sincere purity. He's writing to men and women. So when he uses the deception as a reminder of our tendencies to be deceived by the enemy, that applies to everybody, according to Paul. So that's not what he means here. What does he mean here then? What's going on here? What I'm saying is Paul is highlighting Eve's deception because Satan is up to his old tricks again. He's been trying to wreck marriage from the beginning, back in Eden, and he's doing it again. And he's doing it in much the same way. And he attacks through Eve, through the woman, for a specific reason. Her situation is like his own. He, as an angel, is a ministering spirit sent to serve the heirs of eternal life, of redemption. And he can't stand the idea of serving anyone who's less than you. And so he hates human beings because, as an angelic being, we should be serving him. He, you know, the order, the chain of being, he's top dog, smarter, more powerful. But God, in his inscrutable wisdom, who would send his own son to be a servant, to serve rather than to be served, sent the angels ahead of time to that, and that's where Satan's fall comes. His pride is in refusing to submit to someone who's no better than he. And he's hoping Eve will have the same attitude with respect to her marriage. Why should I submit to this goon? He's no better than I am. Well, it's not about doing it because the other is better. It's doing it for the sake of the Lord. It's doing not because your husband deserves it. It's because Christ deserves it. And it's likewise for the husband to do what he does because Christ deserves it. And what he does is to lay down his life for the wife, if he's following Christ. The false teaching then is there are people who are forbidding people to marry. And furthermore, they're denying, they think the resurrection has already taken place. Christ rose, resurrection's over. Jesus once said that in heaven there's no more giving in marriage or being given in marriage. And these people are thinking that, you know, that's like the ultimate state. And if the resurrection has happened, because Jesus rose, we shouldn't have marriage anymore. Paul deals with this in 1 Corinthians 7, too. We shouldn't have marriage anymore because it just gets in the way of your spiritual life. Don't even roommates sometimes do, don't they? You can't have undivided attention. The devotions can't go on forever. They want to get rid of you, get out of the room or whatever. You know, being married is messy. Having children is messy. Wiping both ends is messy. Those little babies that are crying and whatever. It's all messy. And so the normative application, the remedy for the false teaching, which is denigrating marriage, is to tell wives, look, don't buy the idea that to have a good spiritual life, you got to go on a retreat or get into a convent. You can have the best spiritual life right in the midst of office work that you're doing at the company, or dishwashing at home, or wherever you are. The messiness of life is where our devotional lives soar. Wives will be saved through what others are telling you is an unspiritual work of childbearing. My goodness, it's going to occupy all your energy. How can you possibly live for Christ? Well, if you continue in faith, love, and holiness with propriety, you know, that's the requirement. If you're doing it for the Lord, you can even be a slave and do it for Jesus and have it count for all eternity. So husbands, love. So let me get to the practical applications. I'm almost done. What's marriage like? I've got two analogies to suggest to you. One, it's like a bike ride on a tandem. Not the side-by-side. That's unfair. It's got to be the in-line tandems. And I often use this in marriage counseling where I tell couples, obviously, if there's sin, sin's got to be dealt with. But most of the problems that couples have are with respect to balance. One is a real stickler for the rules, a disciplinarian. The other spouse is, he's like in Zen, nothing bothers him or her. And you say, how can we be united? Well, you see, if you're married, you're glued to the bike. If you're going to go anywhere, it's on the bike. You can't get off it. But how do you correct your spouse? The tendency is to, if the spouse is leaning in hypercorrection, for you to undercorrect so the kid doesn't get, psychologically damaged. And then because you're ignoring, when he throws the milk across the kitchen floor, then now the other spouse is getting more hyper. And so you try to correct the balance by each of you leaning to the other side so we don't completely get off kilter. But you see how unstable that situation is? It's the same thing with if one's a spendthrift and the other is a skinflint. Oh, she spends money like there's no tomorrow. He can't part with his precious money. And so one gets spending more to correct for the one that's spending less. But that's not how to do it. You need, if you've ever ridden these bikes, you want to correct the other person. I don't care whether they want to be corrected or not. You can do it because you're one. All you have to do is become more like them. Lean into their direction, and you're going to watch them irresistibly correcting to the other side. So it is with marriage, because you're one flesh, because God is real, and He makes you one flesh, and so you can count on it anytime you have such a problem. The second analogy that I'm going to use is marriage is like a dance. I usually tell people I met my wife at a prayer meeting, but actually it was at a dance floor. I'm not a great dancer, but we loved dancing back then, and I thought a lot about dancing, and I do think marriage is sort of like a dance. But is it like that kind of a dance? If you're not a very good dancer, dragging your spouse across the floor doesn't look or feel like a dance, does it? That's not the plan. Paul says, love does not insist on its own way. If you're heading off in one direction, dragging her from another, this is not a marriage. This is not what submission looks like or headship. That's baloney. This is totally ludicrous, damaging to you, and really prohibited because it's not like Christ's love for the church. It's instead like this. This is a dance. In order for there to be a dance, one of you is leading for sure, but no one can tell. Even the kids can't tell because it's the slightest little touch of the baby finger. Just the pinky does that, and now you're turning around here, and then you go like this. And so you just touching the touch because when you're one, that's how it works. It's not command central, giving a rule, go left now. And that's how your marriage ought to be if you are married. Now, I know a lot of you are not married, But you now know exactly what God's plan is. And when you start thinking about God's plan, you then have an idea of what God thinks about women. This is why he gave us such a great plan. Everywhere that Christianity has gone, despite our many failures, despite many down times when the church was not giving women the kind of respect they do, but in general, everywhere Christianity has gone, status of women has increased. Christianity was instrumental in ending practices like foot binding in China, which were made illegal in 1912, largely with Christian presence. Widow burning among pre-Christian Scandinavians. You may not even knew that you were widow burning, but you were until the gospel came and was preached. Finns, likewise, Chinese, Maori of New Zealand, some of the American Indian tribes, Hindo-Indians, the Isuti was made illegal in 1829, again with Christian missionary pressure. It spelled the end to female infanticide, and this is perhaps the most dramatic thing that you can prove from archaeological evidence. In the New Testament period, women were despised. So any man who had a baby and it turned out to be a girl, we actually have a letter from Oxyrhynchus where the husband tells his wife, gee, I'm on a business trip, I miss you, honey. If the baby comes and it's a girl, kill it. That's the text. And in fact, they were doing the killing so much that in Rome, based on funerary inscriptions, we know that the ratio of men to women was 30% more men than women in Rome. Why? Outside Rome, in Asia Minor, in North Africa, it was 40% more men than women. They were killing so many of the girls because who wants a daughter? We have Latin inscriptions showing that this is the case. We have times with Adelphi, 600 families, only 1% had two daughters in one case. And in other inscriptions, well, we could go, you get the idea. In terms of the effect on marriage, of course, with so much one-child policy, all the girls getting killed, with these ratios, the men wanting to get married had to marry younger and younger. As a result of the Roman pagans, the median age for marriage was 14. Can you imagine getting married at 14? This is abuse. That's the median. Many of them were much younger than that. But among the Christians, based on funerary inscriptions, not based on their own self-testimony, you know, exaggerating how good they are, based on funeral inscriptions, the median age for Christian girls was 18, 4 years older, marrying gentlemen who are only a few years older than that. Don't let anyone tell you that the Bible has a disparaging view of women. It's got a view that'll set us free and set our lives on fire if we'll just obey it. And let it lead us in our opinions and guide us in our marriages. Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your word that has set us free. We thank you for the dignity that you give us as those who have been created in the image and likeness of God, those who are called to be a kingdom of priests. We have such a high calling as your children. We pray, O Lord, we'd live up to it by the power of your Spirit. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.